In 480 BC, 300 Spartans prepared themselves for death in the mountainous pass of Thermopylae. They knew what was coming, wave upon wave of enemy infantry, determined to force their way past at any cost. Men from as far away as India, Egypt, and Iran, summoned to this place by the king of Persia, the most powerful man in the world. The Spartans and a handful of their allies, led by King Leonidas, would die in a furious, savage display of their courage and military prowess. They sacrificed themselves to save Greece from the ambition of a foreign tyrant, though at their death it was far from apparent they succeeded. One of history's most remarkable fights against the odds would continue until it was resolved in the Straits of Salamis and the blood-soaked fields of Plataea. For centuries, Greece had been overshadowed by great empires to the south and east. But by 700 BC, Greece had emerged as a sophisticated and prosperous civilization. Her people possessed a rich and complex mythology, including the epic tales of the poet Homer. From the Phoenicians, they'd adopted an alphabet, and they'd placed themselves at the forefront of an extensive trading network that spanned the Mediterranean. They'd also begun to establish colonies and settle overseas. Greek civilization could be found not just on the mainland, but throughout the islands of the Aegean, along the west coast of Asia Minor called Ionia, and as far west as Italy and Sicily. Despite a common language, a common mythology, and the many shared customs that differentiated the Greeks from those they termed barbarians, the Greeks warred continuously amongst themselves. A Greek's first loyalty was to his polis, the city-state which dominated politics across the Greek world. Almost always, they fought for control of farmland, a limited commodity given Greece's climate and geography. Despite being riven by such internal divisions, the Greek world would go on to produce some of the world's greatest builders, artists, dramatists, and philosophers. It would also produce a man who's come to be known as the father of history, Herodotus.
Herodotus was an aristocratic Greek from the city of Halicarnassus on the coast in Asia Minor. He's known as the father of history because he was part of a group of geographers and ethnographers who were all writing at the same time in the 5th century. But Herodotus was the first to give us a chronologically structured account of the war, looking at what happened and also why it happened.
Herodotus came from the Greek city of Halicarnassus. It was a multinational city. It was Greek, but there was also quite a strong local Carian community, and there was also quite a strong Iranian element. So Herodotus came from a multiracial, multinational location, which is quite important for the way that he articulates his ideas.
Herodotus, of course, known as the father of history, is the first Western historian, in the sense of somebody who tries to tell a story about things that happened which he wasn't an eyewitness of.
It is thanks to the work of Herodotus that we can follow the events of ancient Greece's own finest hour in such rich detail. Greece would stand alone against the awesome might of a tyrannical power bent on conquest, the Persian Empire. In the 5th century BC, the Persian Empire was the superpower of the Middle East. Its boundaries stretched from the Indus River in the east to Egypt and Asia Minor in the west. It was hardly a power to be trifled with. Yet the Persians would claim that the Greeks, in particular the Athenians, had no one to blame but themselves for the onslaught that was to follow. In 499 BC, the Greek colonies of Ionia erupted in rebellion against their Persian overlord. The Athenians lent their support to this doomed uprising, and by so doing, incurred the wrath of Darius the Great, king of Persia. A first invasion force, commanded by Darius' own son-in-law, Mardonius, was wrecked by a sudden and violent storm off the rocky promontory of Athos. A second expedition made a more promising start, reaching Euboea to exact a bloody revenge against Eritrea, a city that had also given aid to the Ionian rebels. The Persians' next stop, everybody knew, would be Athens, and the city had fair warning of the treatment she could expect if her army was defeated. Persian troops landed in Attica near Marathon and were confronted by the hoplite army of Athens and her ally Plataea. Relying on their own resolve and the brute force of their hoplite infantry, the Greeks charged the Persian lines across a mile of open ground. By rushing into combat with the enemy infantry, the Greeks avoided exposing themselves for too long to the Persian archers. Ferocious fighting ensued, and although the overstretched Greek center was broken in places, the flanks of its army pushed on to envelop the Persian center. The carnage wrought at its heart broke the Persian army. The decisive advantage for Athens had lain in her infantry, her hoplites, and in their equipment and training. The hoplite was a heavy infantryman, typically a small-scale farmer, often called upon to fight for his polis. He was a type of soldier common to all the city-states of Greece, protected by a large round shield of wood and bronze, and by a bronze helmet, breastplate, and greaves. His primary weapon was a bronze-tipped spear about 9 feet in length. Alone, the hoplite was slow-moving and vulnerable, but in the tightly packed formation of the phalanx, he became part of a solid wall of bronze, bristling with spear tips. The Persians, in contrast, were lightly armored with mail tunics and wicker shields, and armed with bows, short spears, and swords. In close-quarter fighting, all the advantages lay with the Greek phalanx.
Greek warfare is the warfare of the city-state, in which those who fight are the relatively privileged, whereas the Persians have got an army for an empire.
Once the Athenians managed to get to grips with the Persians, pushing the Persians back into the sea was a relatively simple maneuver. And so the actual battle, once the Athenians decided to engage, was short, sharp, bloody, ferocious, but above all, rapid.
Over 6,000 Persians were killed on the plain of Marathon, while the Athenian dead numbered just 192, to be immortalized by the artists of a later generation in the friezes of the Parthenon. Athens had been saved, for the time being. In 486 BC, Darius the Great died in the midst of preparing a third great expedition against the Greeks. Although the Greeks might have breathed a sigh of relief at the death of their tormentor, worse was to follow. Darius was succeeded to the royal throne of Persia by his son, Xerxes I. He did not rush to a decision over the fate of Greece. He listened to his advisors, including the ambitious Mardonius, who had led the first disastrous expedition to Greece in 492 BC. Finally, the desire to emulate the conquests of his ancestors and to avenge the defeats of his father prevailed. The preparations for invasion took 3 years and were a testament to the power and wealth of the Persian Empire. The army and fleet that was assembled, if Herodotus is to be believed, was almost beyond imagination. Troops had been assembled from the four corners of the Persian Empire and from all the land in between. There were contingents from India, Bactria, Parthia, Media, Assyria, Arabia, Egypt, Phrygia, and a dozen other countries, each detachment arrayed in the martial splendor of their homeland. Together with the crews of 3,000 assorted vessels of the fleet, Herodotus states the invasion force totaled over 2 million men.
Herodotus's figures on Persian numbers are absolute nonsense. There's no doubt about it that the idea of an army of hundreds of thousands is just about feasible, but armies of millions are just bizarre.
I think there are several things going on in Herodotus' account which leads him to exaggerate the numbers and the scale of the Persian army. First of all, there is a very conscious imitation of Homer, in that Herodotus gives us not just the size of the army, but a catalogue of all the peoples who were there. He goes through them contingent by contingent, tells you whereabouts in the empire they came from, what sort of armour they had, what they looked like, who their leaders were. And the other reason, of course, is the greater the army, the greater the threat to the Greeks, the more amazing the victory when it actually takes place.
The logistical preparations were similarly astounding. A canal was cut at Mount Athos to enable the Persians to avoid the treacherous coastline that had destroyed Mardonius's expedition. Supply dumps were established on the army's intended route as far as Macedonia, and bridges were built across the major rivers. Two bridges of boats were built across the Hellespont. In the spring of 480 BC, the monstrous army finally began its advance from Sardis. Quite naturally, news of these developments horrified the city-states of Greece. It was clear the conquest of all Greece was intended, not merely some punitive raid against Athens. Many Greeks were already agreeing terms with the invader, particularly in Thessaly and Boeotia, the exposed northern parts of the country. So had others, like Argos, who was all-consumed by her bitter rivalry with neighbouring Sparta. Under the leadership of the Spartans, a role which naturally devolved upon them as the dominant military power, representatives from across Greece met at the Isthmus of Corinth. It was obvious that only combined military action stood the slightest chance of success. And so, at Corinth, in the rhetoric of the alliance, all the Greeks who preferred continued freedom to enslavement under a foreign tyrant put aside their differences and formed a Hellenic League.
The formation of the Hellenic League was really quite new for the Greeks, in that it's debatable whether before 481 they had much of a concept of themselves as a nation, rather than seeing themselves just as a collection of individual states. And the Hellenic League is unusual in that we see the Greeks starting to think about the things which unite them.
Achieving agreement in the Greek world between states like Athens and Aegina, Athens and Corinth, was incredibly difficult. They were bitter enemies, and yet, for the sake of the defence of Greece, they sank their differences and joined the Hellenic League.
The initial Greek plan was to hold the pass at Therme in answer to Thessaly's threat to submit to Persia unless they were defended. But the pass was quickly found to be unsuitable for defence. A second line of defence was chosen at the Pass of Thermopylae. The Greek fleet would move to Artemisium to ensure the position was not outflanked by sea. Meanwhile, the Persian forces advanced steadily by land and sea, accepting the supplication of King Alexander of Macedonia, and then of the abandoned Thessalians. The first clash between Greek and Persian came off Scyathus. Three Greek lookout ships were captured by the Persian advance squadrons. But just a few days later, disaster overtook the Persians. With the fleet at anchor off the headland of Sepias, a terrific storm unleashed its full force against the invader. 400 warships were lost, and thousands were drowned. The Greek fleet at Artemisium rejoiced and gave thanks to Poseidon, the god of the sea, for helping to even the odds.
When we have the picture of Xerxes being advised by his counsellors on the best way to conduct the campaign against the Greeks, Herodotus shows us one of his advisers saying there are two great enemies for the Persians, the land and the sea, by which he means, first of all, the land in terms of provisioning, whether it's going to be possible to move the army through such a great space and find supplies. And with the sea, the great enemy is seen as the weather, the possibility of storms attacking the fleet.
Although nominally under the command of the Spartan Eurybiades, the Greek fleet was dominated by its Athenian contingent and commander Themistocles. With 270 ships, the Greeks were still likely to face more than three times their own number. As the Greeks debated a course of action, the Persian admirals initiated a plan designed to trap and destroy the Greeks. A squadron of 200 ships sailed unnoticed around Scyathus and the island of Euboea and headed up the Strait of Euripus. They aimed to sever communications between the Greek army at Thermopylae and the Greek fleet at Artemisium, seriously compromising the position of both. But the weather intervened yet again to aid the Greeks, and 2 days after their departure, the squadron was smashed to pieces by more storms in the hollows of Euboea. At Artemisium, in 3 days of escalating skirmishes, the Greeks fought hard and with success, taking advantage of the poorly coordinated movements of the storm-damaged Persian fleet. But after sustaining heavy losses in hard fighting on the third day, the Greek commanders planned a withdrawal to Salamis. Plans turned into hasty action when terrible news reached them from Thermopylae. The Pass of Thermopylae had been an obvious position for the Greeks to choose. It had been used before and would be used again to defend Greece from invaders. The pass running east-west between Thessaly and Locris was formed by the space between the sheer face of the cliffs of Trachis to the south and the Malian Gulf to the north. In the summer of 480 BC, 5,000 hoplites led by King Leonidas and 300 Spartans arrived to stop the Persians, rebuilding ancient fortifications, the Phocian Wall, to help them. These troops were an advance guard, with orders to buy time for the rest of Greece to mobilize its strength. It was early September when the Persian host arrived at Thermopylae and made camp on the banks of the river Melas near Trachis. Xerxes' scouts reported to him that a small force of Greeks were preparing to hold the pass, led by Spartans. Xerxes had heard stories of the courage and professionalism of these men, but he could not bring himself to believe that such a tiny force would contemplate resisting him.
Xerxes knew quite a lot about the Spartans. At the Persian court, there had regularly been a number of Greek exiles, usually quite prominent Greeks, who have chosen to throw in their lot with the Persians and who see the Persians as a way back into power at home.
His knowledge of the Spartans was undoubtedly very accurate because Demaratus, one of the Spartan kings, had been deposed and fled to Persia to seek sanctuary and to make his fortune at the court of Xerxes. And Herodotus shows us Demaratus functioning as an advisor to Xerxes. He actually came with him on the expedition. And he shows us at various points Xerxes going to Demaratus and asking for information. Now, the way in which this is shown is generally very favourable to the Spartans, in that Xerxes, Herodotus suggests to us, goes and asks sort of about, is it true that the Spartans are so brave? Is it true that they're really so invincible in warfare? And Demaratus, being a Spartan, obviously talks them up and says, yes, they are. The stories you've heard may be exaggerated, but nevertheless, the Spartans are by far the best warriors. They respect the law. They have no fear of any other enemy.
The Persian king waited 4 days, waking every morning expecting to hear the Greeks had run off. On the 5th day, with mounting irritation, he ordered his infantry to force the pass. What followed was pure slaughter. In the narrow confines of the pass, the Persians were forced to assault the Greek lines head-on. The hoplites, with their longer spears and heavy armour, inflicted massive casualties on the invaders. The Spartans set an example for the other Greeks to follow, dispatching hundreds with clinical efficiency. The Greeks fought in relays. After a period on the front line, a detachment would retire behind the Phocian wall to rest and regain strength. Xerxes sent in reinforcements, packing more and more soldiers into the confined space of the pass. This only helped the assault degenerate into chaos. For 2 days, this carnage continued. But at the close of the 2nd day, a local man named Ephialtes sought an audience with Xerxes. Expecting a rich reward, he told the Persian king about a track that ran through the Anapaea Mountains that would enable the Persians to descend behind the Greek position. That night, Ephialtes led the immortals along the track. Leonidas also knew of the Anapaea path and had posted 1,000 men from Phocis to guard the route. But these men, startled by the sudden appearance of a large force of Persians, were simply brushed aside. Greek lookouts raced in at dawn with news of a large body of men descending from the mountains behind them. Leonidas knew exactly what was unfolding and what it meant. A Spartan would never quit his station through fear of death. But he could not ask as much from his Greek allies, and he urged them to go home before the Persians blocked the only escape route. Perhaps Leonidas was also inspired by an oracle his homeland had received. In the war with Persia, it had said either a king of Sparta would die, or Sparta itself would fall. Leonidas and his 300 Spartans would remain, accompanied by the Thebans and what remained of the 700 hoplites from Thespiae, who refused to leave. The first assault began before the immortals had reached the Greek position. With so few men, the Greeks were hard-pressed to hold the line, and Leonidas was amongst those cut down. 2 brothers of Xerxes were also killed in furious fighting. As the Persian immortals arrived behind the Greek line, the dwindling band retired in a tight body to a small hill. under a hail of Persian arrows, the last Spartan fell. But the Persians had been forced to pay a heavy toll for use of the road at Thermopylae. Xerxes vented his wrath by having the corpse of Leonidas decapitated and his head planted on a stake.
There's no doubt that Persian casualties were very heavy in forcing the pass at Thermopylae. In their numerous attempts to take the position by frontal assault, they would have suffered horrendously in the confined space against much more heavily armed Greek infantry. And if there's one thing that the Persian Wars taught the Persians, it's that in head-to-head confrontations, 9 times out of 10, their infantry would lose out to the Greek infantry.
The Spartan stand at Thermopylae is undoubtedly more important for what it represents than for what it actually achieved at the time, in that it became a byword for Greek heroism in the face of insurmountable odds.
Undoubtedly, the Greek hope was that the obstruction to Persian progress could have been long-term. The Greeks had not expected the Persians to find a way around the defile at Thermopylae. So in some senses, the loss of these brave warriors, their sacrifice, represented a failure. They had held the Persians up for perhaps a week, not much more, but the Persian steamroller marched on.
With the retreat from Artemisium, central Greece was now exposed to the Persians. Xerxes advanced unopposed into Boeotia, then Attica. As the country of the Athenians, ringleaders of Greek resistance and principal troublemakers, the entire region was devastated. The population fled to the ports of Athens, and from there they were evacuated by the fleet to Salamis, Aegina, and Troezene. At the end of September, Persian troops entered Athens itself. The resistance of a handful of diehards who had fortified themselves on the Acropolis was quickly overcome. And then, the city and its temples were burnt. The Peloponnesians, determined to save their own homes, worked frenziedly to fortify the Isthmus of Corinth. At Salamis, the fleet commander, Eurybiades, held a conference. The Peloponnesian commanders demanded the fleet be withdrawn to the Isthmus to prevent the defences being outflanked by sea. But the Athenian Themistocles argued that at the Isthmus the fleet would be forced to fight in open seas, where the Persian numerical advantage would be more telling. But most significantly, if the position of Salamis was abandoned, Themistocles threatened to withdraw the entire Athenian contingent. Currently it composed half the total strength of 378 ships. Themistocles went even further. He sent a trusted servant to beg an audience with Xerxes. This man told the king that the Greeks had been seized by panic and were preparing to escape. This was just the sort of information Xerxes expected to hear. Immediately, a squadron of Egyptian ships was detached to block the Greeks' escape route. When this news reached the Greek commanders, it was clear that their only option was to fight. Themistocles had got his way through haranguing, blackmail, and deceit.
Themistocles is described in our sources as the man who had the greatest foresight of any of the Greeks of his time, which is an interesting formulation. He was renowned in among the Greeks primarily for his deviousness, for his ability to manipulate a situation. On this occasion, he was instrumental in persuading the Persians to fight at Salamis, because what needs to be remembered is that the Persians really didn't need to fight a naval engagement at this point.
It's really important for Themistocles to fight a battle at Salamis for a whole variety of reasons. Most important of which is that the Spartans were already suggesting to the Athenians that they abandon central and northern Greece and they pull back to the Peloponnese, and that's the best way to fight the Persians. And Themistocles knows that for Athens would be an utter disaster. It would be the end of Athens as a serious power. It would mean abandoning the Athenian lands to Persian occupation. And of course, one of the first consequences of that decision would be to strengthen the faction within Athens itself that wants to deal with the Persians rather than the Spartans. So it's extremely important to fight the Battle of Salamis for Themistocles. Indeed, if he doesn't fight that battle, it's difficult to see politically where he has to go.
The Persian fleet attacked the next morning, eager to capture and destroy the Greek fleet before it attempted to escape. As the Persians rushed into the narrows full of confidence, they were met head-on by the Greek triremes. The Athenians on the right flank engaged the Phoenicians. Spartans and other Greeks engaged the Ionians on the left. As the advance squadrons of the Persian fleet tried to retire in the face of the Greek onslaught, they met their own reserves head-on, and the whole fleet fell into confusion and disorder. Bitter fighting followed, with the Greek squadron from Aegina falling upon the Persian left flank with decisive timing. The Persians fought hard, under the eyes of their king, who watched from Mount Aigaleos. But finally, they abandoned the struggle. In the savagery and confusion of the narrows, they had lost 200 ships. The Greeks had lost about 40. The disaster of Salamis traumatized Xerxes. When Mardonius, the army's commander, proposed that he continue the campaign with a smaller army of picked troops, the king quickly agreed. The fleet was evacuated to the Hellespont to guard the bridges and allow Xerxes and the bulk of the army to return to Asia. Mardonius withdrew as far as Macedonia and Thessaly to spend the winter resting and reorganizing and preparing for the completion of the conquest in spring. That spring, Mardonius's first move was to send an envoy to Athens in an attempt to break up the Hellenic League. Despite generous offers, the Athenians swore to fight on until the sacrileges committed on their soil by the Persians were avenged. Thus war was renewed in 479 BC. The Persian army swept down into Attica, ravaging a deserted countryside, burning farms and slaughtering refugees where they could be found. Athens itself was sacked a second time in June. The Peloponnesians continued to improve the fortifications of the Isthmus of Corinth, looking to secure their own homes before offering battle. But with Attica in flames, along with Plataea, Megara, and Thespiae, and the potential catastrophe that would follow if these regions defected to the Persian invader, a military sortie by the Peloponnesian states became imperative.
The Peloponnesian states saw it as very tempting to retreat behind a wall on the isthmus and defend that, because it meant that they could defend their own territory against the Persians. Whereas you have to remember that the Athenians by this stage had already seen their city captured by the Persians and sacked. The temples had been burnt and the whole of the city had been devastated. And the Athenians obviously had lost everything.
The Athenians effectively threatened to abandon the Greek cause and migrate off to Western Greece and set up a new Athenian city in Sicily or Sardinia if the Greeks did not move out and help them to regain their homeland. And that was the crunch.
5,000 Spartans headed north under Pausanias, regent for the infant son of the dead king Leonidas. They were joined at Eleusis by the Athenian hoplites and contingents from across Greece. In response, Mardonius withdrew from Attica via Decelea and Tanagra into Boeotia. He'd chosen to fight near Thebes, where the terrain better suited his cavalry. In the vicinity of Plataea, and in the shadow of Mount Kithaeron, a large wooden fort was erected as a Persian camp. In late August, the Greek coalition force arrived on the lower slopes of Kithaeron to face them. The core of the army, as always, were the hoplites, over 35,000 of them from across Greece. But there were also twice as many light infantry, such as archers, slingers, and other skirmishers. As the Greek troops arrived on the lower slopes of Mount Kithaeron, they came under heavy attack from Persian cavalry. Successive waves of horsemen advanced for a brief exchange of blows, arrows, and insults. Eventually, these attacks ceased after Mesistius, the Persian cavalry commander, was unhorsed and butchered by the Greeks. It was August in the rugged terrain of central Greece, and the need to find an adequate supply of drinking water for the men became critical. The Greeks therefore advanced to take up new positions near the spring of Gargaphia, where fresh water was plentiful. They formed up with 10,000 hoplites from Sparta and its surrounding countryside on the right. Next to them were 1,500 hoplites from Tegea, then 5,000 hoplites from Corinth, over 7,000 hoplites from the various other city-states of the Peloponnese, and finally on the left wing, the 8,000 hoplites of Athens, under the command of Aristides. Mardonius, the Persian commander, had deployed his best infantry, the men from Persia itself, opposite the Spartans. Men from the various provinces of the empire formed the center, including Medes, Bactrians, Indians, and Scythians. On the right wing, facing the Athenians, were men from the many Greek states that had defected to the Persian cause, including Macedonians, Thessalians, and the Boeotians. In the blistering heat, the two armies eyed each other warily across the Asopus, both reluctant to make the first move.
On the battlefield of Plataea, quite a long standoff, about a week, did develop. The Persians could hope that the Greeks would be unable to maintain their strong position, their strong defensive position, if their supplies, particularly their supplies of water, were threatened. The Greeks would be forced to withdraw, and this reverse would damage Greek morale.
The standoff developed because both sides held ground which they felt was advantageous to them tactically. They were divided by the river Asopus, and neither side wanted to advance over the river because that would give the enemy an advantage. And equally, the Persians were holding ground that was good for their cavalry and wanted to stay and fight in that particular terrain.
Curiously enough, you look at the Battle of Plataea, time is almost certainly on the Persian side. Rather than the Greek side. The Greeks needed the victory, and they didn't have much time. The Persians didn't need to win a victory, they could wear the Greeks down, and they probably had a bit more time.
What really made the difference was that the Persians were finally able to cut Greek lines of communication. And when they did that, the Greeks did then become vulnerable. And that was really what triggered them into the movements which led to the final battle.
After 10 days of isolated skirmishes, Mardonius ordered his commanders to prepare their men for a dawn assault. The next day, the Persian cavalry launched constant and large-scale cavalry attacks on the Greek line. Their tactic was to gallop in towards their target, unleash arrows and javelins at close range, and then wheel away to regroup. But at the end of the day, the exhausted Greeks still held their positions. The Persians did, however, succeed in spoiling the spring of Gargaphia. So Pausanias decided to withdraw that night to a new position in front of Plataea, where water would again be easily available. That night, the withdrawal began. As so often when large armies attempt complex maneuvers at night, everything rapidly descended into chaos. Most of the Greeks marched straight for Plataea, seeking shelter from the Persian cavalry that had harassed them for days on end. A Spartan commander, Amompharetus, refused to withdraw his regiment at all, declaring it was not the Spartan way. The Athenians looking on might have been bemused, but as dawn approached, the seriousness of the situation was all too obvious. The Greek army was fragmented, scattered across the plain and terribly exposed. As the sun came up, Pausanias called Amompharetus's bluff, marching off without him and his men. The isolated Spartan contingent soon set off to catch up with the main body of Spartans. As soon as Mardonius saw the Greeks had gone, he launched his whole army after them in pursuit. Moments after the stubborn Amompharetus had rejoined formation, the Persian cavalry were on top of them. Alongside their loyal allies, the Tegeans, they turned to fight. The retreating Athenians were hidden from sight by the lie of the land, but when messages arrived from Pausanias begging for their aid, they immediately set off in his direction. As they did so, Mardonius's Greek allies fell upon them, and soon the Athenians were themselves fighting for their lives. The Spartans and Tegeans could hope for no reinforcement as the bulk of the Persian infantry approached their position. When they drew near, the Persians formed a barricade with their wicker shields, and from behind it poured arrows into the Greek ranks. Hoplites began to fall as the fusillade of arrows found gaps in their armor. As more and more Persians arrived in front of the Spartan position, including Mardonius himself, the hoplites continued to hold ranks. Then, at last, with the sanction of their priests, who had at last got favorable omens, the Spartans and Tegeans charged. Isolated and outnumbered, the Greeks fought ferociously. The wall of wicker shields collapsed under their assault, and the hoplites pushed on. Beyond was a mass of Persian infantry, disorganized by their rush across the Asopus. The Greeks were used to fighting men covered in armor similar to their own, and they found lightly armored Persians easy to kill. The Persians certainly did not lack courage, but in the face of the disciplined onslaught of the Spartans and their allies, they were simply overrun. Mardonius, at the heart of his personal guard of 1,000 men, fell as his men were butchered around him. With Mardonius dead and the Spartans killing with increasing fluency, all the fight went out of the Persian infantry. En masse, they turned and ran for the safety of the wooden fort. When the Athenians arrived, and further reinforcements from Plataea, they succeeded in breaching the wooden walls. Everyone inside was slaughtered. After the Battle of Plataea, the only Persians left in Greece were desperately seeking to escape. Greece had been saved. Around the same time, another engagement was fought by Greek marines at Mykale. Hoplite tactics gave them another decisive victory. Greece was not only safe, she'd begun to fight back. The following year, the city-states of Greece would form the Delian League, a military alliance designed to take revenge upon the Persian Empire for the atrocities and destruction she had inflicted. Greece grew rich from its success, and a new Athens rose from the ashes of the old. Before the end of the century, Greeks would lapse again into their brutal internecine wars. But by escaping the tyrannical ambitions of the king of Persia, the city-states had survived to create more than the military legend of Thermopylae.
The consequences of the Greek victories in 480-479, the repulse of the Persians, were wide-ranging. It is 5th century Athens which gives us the ideal of democracy. It is 5th century Athens which developed the forms, the processes, and laid out many of the fundamentals of philosophical thought.
The Athenians used the Persian Wars as a springboard to found their own empire. The concern in the immediate years after the Persian Wars was to defend against a second attack, because the Greeks didn't at that stage think that the Persians had been comprehensively defeated. They didn't think they wouldn't come back. And out of this defence then sprang the Athenians' 5th century empire, allowing them to build the city of Athens in the form that we recognise it today.
It's difficult not to believe that if Persia had defeated the Greeks, and something vital would have been taken out of that part of the world.
If the Greeks hadn't won, the whole notion of fighting for freedom, of freedom or death, that would not have come through so forcefully, because the fight for freedom would have failed, and we would have lived in a world with a very different set of values.
We'll be right back.